From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
Good afternoon, everyone. Hi, I'm Mark Dimunation. Welcome back to Rare Book and Special Collections Division. I'm very excited about today for a couple of reasons. One, this is a great opportunity for us here in Rare Books to welcome one of the great bookbinders in America, Daniel E. Kelm. Those of you who play with contemporary book arts inevitably will have run into Daniel's bindings. Those of you from the Corcoran, I was relating to Daniel a funny story where we were doing a binding session for one of your classes, and I had gone through the stacks and had pulled up interesting bindings I thought I would show the class. And after about the fifth time that someone said, "And whose binding is that?" And I said, "Well, that's Daniel Kelm. That's Daniel Kelm. That's Daniel Kelm." It was clear that this is the man that's shaped bindings in the contemporary book world, but it's much more important and happy for me because he's a real mensch and he's a lovely, lovely man, and it shows through in his bindings. So he's going to be doing something different today. He'll be talking about his books and showing you some books. He asked how long he could go and then gave me a target. I said the building closed before then. But I said, if you can stop at 4 o'clock to allow the lunch hour people or the people who have to leave at four to get up and leave, we'll allow you a 4 o'clock exodus, after which George is locking us in, and we're gonna be here until this man is finished. Thank you very much. No, he'll go over to the table and we're gonna try and create a conversation about what it means to bind. I've learned a lot from Daniel, both personally and also about book arts. It's the same world after all. There's a certain kind of unassuming striving for perfection that you find in his bindings that makes him such an adorable person and such a good binder. It's very quiet and very unassuming and very deliberate, but it's always there. He's taught me that materials matter and that materials are both the problem and the answer, and that you have to learn how to listen to them in order to understand what to do. And most importantly, I think for anyone who has given him a text and said, "Please bind this," he's taught me that the combination of a text and a binding and a collaborative effort elevates everyone's work to something quite unexpected that would not have existed had the two not combined in a particular way. So I think it's really a model for living. I really believe that. He and I come from the same part of the country, just a few blocks away from each other. We had a lovely afternoon many years back now, it seems, drinking tea and talking about accordion lessons in Minnesota State Fairs and all the things you think I didn't do. it's just a real thrill. I know you're really going to enjoy what he has to say. And without that, say hello to Daniel E. Kelm.
Thank you so much. Thank you. I was going to say something about growing up nearby in Minnesota, had you not said that. And the state fair just happened.
Yes.
You know, we should go back there together sometime.
We should.
Oh, and for those of you that don't know me but came just on the strength of that lovely poster that's out in the hallway, I just wanted to confirm that you are indeed in the right location. this is me. How many of you are makers? Do you guys make books? Yeah. Like Mark said, the material is so important. You know, there's form and function, material. It's a dialogue with the material. I've really learned that I need to talk with the material, and some of it is so interesting to talk with. I started out as and I'll show you some images just to give you a little bit of background about me, but I started out you know, in Minnesota, and I was a quiet kid, and frankly, I was so quiet, I was kind of awkward and scared and spent a lot of time by myself, but I fell in love with chemistry one day when I tried to make perfume. I don't know why, 7 years old maybe, and I was going to make perfume, and I thought, well, perfume smells pretty strongly. I should just take all of the chemicals in the house, all the materials that smell strongly, and put them together, and that'll make a pretty good perfume. So, you know, what smells strongly? Well, Clorox bleach. I thought that's a good material to start with. And hydrochloric acid, or the technical grade muriatic acid. So I put them together, and what do you get? Does anybody know? Well, you can. I fell short of explosion. I did go on to make great explosions later on, which if I did now, I wouldn't be here today because I'd be in jail someplace probably. When my wife and I got together, I asked her if she'd ever made gunpowder, and she said no. Can you believe that? She never did make gunpowder before. So we made gunpowder and used it to patina metal. And beautiful fire patinas on metal. But no, you get chlorine gas when you make, when you put those materials of Clorox and hydrochloric acid together. And so I filled the basement with chlorine gas, filled my lungs with chlorine gas, walked around the block a couple times trying to draw air again. And when I got back to the back to my lab, my dad kicked me into the lab out of the house. But someone helped me write down the equation of and hydrochloric acid and sodium hypochlorite making chlorine gas, and it just grabbed me because here I had the feeling of the gas in my lungs and I had an equation in front of me that I could understand intellectually what had happened in that container. So the combination of the intellectual understanding of that reaction and the physical feeling of the gas captured me. I thought it was thrilling. And so I went on to be a chemist and taught chemistry at the University of Minnesota in the early to late 70s. And then decided I had crawled up in my head too much and I was looking at the world through my eye sockets, but I was just intellectualizing everything. And I wanted to get back into my body, so I thought, what should I do? What should I do? I need to make something like I had made things when I was a kid. And I had collected books and actually my library. Now, this is Minnesota. Remember, it used to be a lot colder there than it is now, but 35 below in January was the standard. And so I felt like Faust in Goethe's story. I had took a walk-in closet and I lined it with books. And I had my, I can never remember whether it's an easy boy or a lazy boy recliner, but I put my chair in there and it would insulate me from the cold weather. I would just sit there and read all the time. So I fell in love with books and I decided to make books. So I went right from chemistry and philosophy departments at the University of Minnesota to the library bindery on campus and started making Class A library bindings, which lasted about 3 months. And then I moved to Boston and started taking classes at Harcourt Bindery, which had been founded in 1900 and was making leather bindings. And one of the last places that was doing extensive gold tooling and edge gilding, and they hired me as the finisher, the edge builder and the finisher doing the gold work. And I chased gold leaf for a number of years, and it was great fun to start from that craft perspective because I didn't have an art background. I had always been a chemist, you know, for making that chlorine gas on. But it gave me a way to look at the world to understand materials. So what Mark was saying about materials. I love dialoguing with materials and seeing what materials would like to do, and then I use the expressiveness of that material in my work. Oh, and the phrase that's up here, or poetic science, I went right from chemistry to book arts, but I continued a conversation or a study about alchemy, because the alchemists were the most recent scientific revolution worldview that didn't posit that separation between us and the material that we're working with. I'm a scientist through and through, but one thing that I don't like is that objectification of the material. You know, we have to separate from what we're studying now. We're right there with it, especially as an artist. We gain so much understanding and so much energy from handling the materials. That's why I ask how many are makers. I love handling the materials, and it I think it keeps me young. I'm really only about 12 years old, so it's... Oh, and I named my studio the Wide Awake Garage in memory of my grandfather. And he died when I was 11 years old, but I really loved him. And during a strike, he was the chief electrician for the Great Northern Railroad. And during a strike in the 20s, probably, he had left the railroad and started a garage in Buffalo, Minnesota, called the Wide Awake Garage. And I went to the fair with him every year. And I remember mostly his wool pants. And I would just hold on to his wool pants, and he would lead me through the fair. Yeah, so the initial sighting is here. That's, can you guys see? My dad was a professional photographer. And whenever he saw me doing something in the backyard, he'd grab his camera and come out and photograph. So, you know, we've got a table and a chair, and Greta, my wife, loves to point out that even at that age, I made a lectern for myself. I think the next thing is a ladder, but I'm not absolutely certain what that is. But I had a, you know, this sounds funny now, but I had a very special relationship with the garbage man. You know, we had an alley behind the garage, and they'd come every week and take stuff away. Well, he'd often leave more stuff for me than he took away, because he knew that I liked to build things. Does everybody or anybody recognize her? Madam Chiang Kai-shek. My dad worked for Bachrach Studios here in D.C., 1943. Fabian Bachrach didn't have clearance to come to the White House to do the photography, but my dad did, so, you know, Chiang Kai-shek's probably talking with FDR about the progress of the war, and my dad was to photograph Madame Chiang Kai-shek, and while she was being interviewed by reporters, he had a nice 5-minute conversation with Eleanor Roosevelt, and then suggested that the two first ladies pose together, so Eleanor Roosevelt's kneeling on the ground next to Madame Chiang Kai-shek. And I show these because these photographs hung in my dad's studio, the one that I gassed with the chlorine gas. He had a studio in the basement. And I used to look at them, and there was something about these photographs that really impressed me. They brought together something, and I didn't realize what it was until later in life. But there are four elements that I see in these photographs that I try to bring to all of my work. There's the personal. My father took these photographs, he talked to these people, he was able to tell me a story about the conversations. There's the historical. This was an interesting and important point in history. 1943, the war is going on. This is on the White House lawn. And then there's the aesthetic. I love the composition. And the technical. I used to watch him develop black and white photographs in the darkroom, and that's what got me interested in chemistry and consequently in understanding materials in a certain way. So personal, historical, the aesthetic, and the technical. Those four points I try to bring to all of my work. And these two photographs kind of represent that for me. Mm-hmm. So there I am before I got kicked out of the house, me in the lab. My studio, and actually I'm starting to do some installations now. I did some video work for the Smithsonian reproducing James Smithson's chemistry, blowpipe analysis, and I thought I should really recreate my lab as a little installation. Great fun. This was my favorite book at that point. If you ever find a copy of this book, get it. It's actually gotten rather valuable. It's a banned book. Published in 1960, pulled off the shelves a couple years later, thought to contain too much potent information for young people. I didn't think it went far enough, but you know, it told me how to make chlorine gas, I guess. Oh, and there's my grandfather. So the Wide Awake Garage. On the back of this photograph, my mom had written Wide Awake Garage, and that's him and the boater, the straw boater, and probably my uncle. But I love that. You know, here's a car garage, and in the back, I didn't put this photograph in, there's a lathe and metalworking equipment. You couldn't just buy stock items. He was always having to fabricate things. So it inspired me to see him work on things and make things. And I've always loved making things and handling materials. And I guess it started with him and my dad. They were always tinkering around the house.
building things, adding onto the house. So Wide Awake Garage is the name of my studio. I coined the phrase interpretive fine binding, which I didn't think would be controversial, but when I lectured in England, there's usually someone that says, it should be interpretative fine binding. And then someone else says, oh, shut up and let him continue. So interpretive fine binding it is. And then the line underneath you may not be able to read, but it says, it's not a garage. And that, I heard that phrase on the radio when I was building my studio 30 years ago on the fifth floor of an old mill building in East Hampton, Massachusetts. And I don't know what the context was, but it stuck. But I still, to this day, get calls from people saying they want their car worked on. And I say, if you can get it up to the fifth floor of the building, I'd be happy to give it a try. I don't think any of the elevators are large enough, so I might be in good shape. So at this point, you know, I want to look at books, but this is a big, big crowd. So I don't know how far I'll go into this. You think one of the videos? Huh?
Some of each.
Some of each? Okay.
You should see your bindings, at least some.
Yeah, so and seeing me handle them, so the video. So I'll play a yeah, so bear with me for just, now you know what, I'm gonna continue on this, and then we've got books, and I'll hold up some books so that you can see some, and then afterwards, after four, we can, you can come and take a look at some of these close up. When I started, you know, this is a quarter leather binding. I did 10 copies of this for Barry Moser. He had illustrated it for the Limited Edition Club. And he said, I want quarter leather bindings. Now, quarter leather means, you know, the spine is covered in leather and the boards are covered in some other material. Here it's black cloth. I didn't want to do just the straight join that you normally see between the leather and the cloth because I wanted, on first glance, to see something from the interior of the book. So when you see that design, what associations would it bring?
Greek key,
running Greek key, vase, you know, so it just, and here it is, the Odyssey of Homer. So just in a small way, bringing a little bit out from the interior of the book to give an idea of what it is. So, you know, you really can't judge a book by its cover, but there's a lot of effort trying to, you know, do a binding in a way that does give you an introduction. It is, when you look at the book, it's the first time you see the book. It can introduce a little bit of what's going on inside. I did a lot of books with Alan James Robinson, who's the proprietor and illustrator, the owner of Chelonidae Press, and he's in East Hampton, Massachusetts. And again, just trying to bring a little bit of the interior. So here we've got Mark Twain's Jumping Frog, and Alan had done a series of four images of frogs, one sitting about to jump, one in full flight, and the second one kind of extended farther and then landing on the back. And I think, yeah, here we go. So here the frog jumps through the book. And again, always wanting to play with materials. On the outside, you've got you know, leather onlay with tooling on a leather binding, but inside it's leather onlay on paper. Because I always want to play with contrast and changing the combinations. It's rare that you see leather on paper for these onlays. So, and it has a different set of specifications, and it was just fun to play with. I never tried to make a lot of money doing this. I do it because I'm passionate. I shouldn't say that to anybody who wants to buy a book. I'm an old hippie, what can I say? I love doing this stuff. And I do it as a challenge and because it's a passion of mine. And this probably was in an edition of 30 or 35 copies. And I have to say, does anybody know, he's passed now, but Fritz Eberhardt? You know Fritz, he was in Philadelphia. A lot of German bookbinders came over at the beginning of World War II, and Fritz and Trudy ended up in Philadelphia. And Fritz was such a he had a real edge to him. And I can remember the first time that I met him was at the first standard seminar, which was at the Folger, just down the street. Must be at least 30 years ago. And Fritz stood up and really went off on something. And that was my first exposure to him. So I was always a little afraid of Fritz. And he came to the studio one day, and I was working on this this edition, and so I didn't really want to show it to him, but he picked it up, and I thought, oh man, here we go. Turned it over in his hands, handed it back to me, I can't find a flaw. Thank you, thank you. I was going to get raked over the coals, I thought. No, it was, yeah, I felt better about that afterwards. Barry Moser, who had Penny Roll Press and Hampshire Typothetai, is just a couple of towns over from where I am, and I wanted to do one of his copies of the Arian Press Moby Dick. Who's Arian Press, right? The Moby Dick? Yeah. And a lot of people had had trouble with it because the paper is rather puffy, and you know, and I talked with Philip Smith and with Don Glaister about it, and they had each found copies, and they had difficulty figuring out what thread to use, and might have had to re-sew it to get the right swell. Well, notice something here. So here I'm playing with structure because of the requirements of the material. If you don't know traditional sewing, well, this is raised cord sewing, but in traditional raised cord sewing, there's usually a kettle stitch. I'll stand over here for just a moment and point this out. So at the top and at the bottom, there would be holes in the sections where the thread would emerge to go into the next section. I didn't want to line the spine. The kettle stitch is traditionally kind of a weak spot in the sewing and can be stabilized by putting a glued lining over it. So, but in this case, I wanted to leave the raised cords exposed, not put a lining over them. It was kind of, it added to the nautical theme. It looked like cordage. But I didn't want to have the kettle stitch because I wasn't going to line the spine. So the way that I resolved this is that rather than the thread going all along inside the section, there's a stainless steel rod that runs along the inside of the section. So each of those sewing supports, each of the cords, has a designated thread. The thread goes around the cord, into the section, around the stainless steel rod, and then right back out to wrap around the cord. So you eliminate the thread going all along on the inside, which eliminates the need for a kettle stitch, because it doesn't have to exit to enter the next section. So it was a nice resolution, except the spine. If you take the book and put it flat, it can move head to tail. If you take the front cover, and it will move head to tail because there's no stabilization that way. It's a good, strong binding. I sent it to the client, and I got a nice note back, and he said, very lovely binding, even though it's unfinished. He wanted a full letter binding.
Nope.
He kept the book and he was very happy with it. And he wanted to make his point that he would have liked a full leather binding. Yeah.
And that's actually, the covers are covered in suede but then painted. So there is leather on the cover, but it's painted leather. And you can see the opening, you know, what I like about that kind of binding is that it has great flexibility. You know, and the whole problem with the puffiness of the paper, I could just increase the diameter of the stainless steel rod to give the kind of swell that I needed in order for the shape of the spine to work well. But that meant because the book has that kind of movement, both flexibility in opening, but also movement head to tail, the box that constructed for this had angled sidewalls on the inside. So locate the book and then angle the sidewalls on the top, so when you close the box, it registered the top and the bottom covers directly over each other. So the box would compensate for the flexibility in the binding in terms of closing it properly. Hey, Ralph. This sort of book interested me greatly when I was young. When I'm young and then starting bookbinding, you know, liturgical texts, I don't read the language, but there's something so important about the look of this book. There's a presence to it. I wanted to do sculptural bindings. There was something about that. So I started playing, again, on a Chalanadai press book with doing sculptural bindings. And this is D.H. Lawrence Poem's Tortoises. And I did 5 copies of this. And in the poems, Lawrence talks about the young tortoise burrowing up through the sand, carrying the burden of the cross on its back, and marching off past his mother, not even recognizing her. So small tortoise on the front cover and detail of large tortoise on the back cover. And it's the only addition that I did with sculpted wood under the leather. After this, I mean, I spent probably a week in the backyard sculpting the pieces of wood for the 5 copies. After this, I started doing cast materials rather than individually sculpted materials. And this was a good example. It's a one of a kind, but boy, this one took me a long time. Stanley Morrison's 4 Centuries of Fine Printing. And it was a commission from a friend in Toronto. And let's see, on the next slide, just so you can see the relief. It's a, you know, rounded and backed binding, hand sewn silk end bands, but you can see the relief of the strap work on the, let's see if I can go back in. So that's about 1/4 inch relief. And, you know, normally you would find this in 2-dimensional onlay, but I wanted to give it 3 dimensions to bring it up through the 4 centuries of books that he's talking about in this text. So the way that I did that was to take a bootstrap. I found it's a strap work design. I should start with a strap, soak it in molten sculpting wax, and then on a piece of glass that had the pattern underneath it, actually build the strap work out of that waxed strap. And then using plaster and wax and probably silicone resin, I did a casting of the strap work, and then did a resin casting of that. And by going back and forth, I was able to come up to a plaster positive and a silicone rubber negative. And then that yellow leather actually covers the whole front cover of the book, and then has blue and black on top of it as onlays. But by thinning that leather down, it's vegetable tan goat skin, and soaking it and putting it between the plaster positive and the resin negative, it would dry out in that shape with that 1/4 inch relief. And then that was backed with silicone rubber in the same cast from the same form, so that the strap work is solid because it's got a backing of silicone rubber, but it is just very thin onlay weight leather. And then, as I said, the blue was onlaid on top of the yellow, and the FCFP and the little device in the center were stamped and then onlaid with black leather on top of that. So anyway, lots of steps, you know, but process. I'm really into the process of this and communicating with the material, you know, dialoguing with the material. I think this book is here today, isn't it?
Is there?
No.
Later?
Another book with Alan James Robinson, and you know, it's about a swan and a young woman, and we don't have another picture here, but you can see the angled walls here. So it's a, you know, it's a fleshy binding because of the nature of the story. So alum tod pigskin with low relief sculpture paper, cast paper taken from one of Al's images in the book. But then when you put the book into the box, it closes on both sides with those angled sidewalls. So it's like the wings of the swan enclosing the fleshy book. So wherever possible, I try to use materials that represent something from the story, of course the forms also. And integrating the box and the book has become important to me. The box isn't just a storage device. It really can be integrated with the binding to help tell the story or support the story. Uh-oh, people are starting to leave.
No, there's a cough going around.
Married Metal Press did a new edition of Billy Budd, and you know, low relief, but this one was actually nautical nylon that was, the rope was all taken apart. It's not just twisted, but it's actually woven back together. And I chose the one moment in the story where color is talked about. It's when his body is raised by a gang of three or four to the yardarm when he's hanged on board ship. It catches the first rosy rays of dawn. So using scarf joined leather, you know, green below for the dark green for the ocean, and then progressive dyeing of the scarlet leather with the rays of the sun from the lower right. So again, catching a moment from the story in the binding itself. This was a one-of-a-kind book binding done on one of Fitz and Fitzgerald's editions, illustrated by Nicolette Jellin, and it's called Dog Story. And there are a few words in the book, but it's mainly images of four characters. There's a dog, and you can see the crescent-shaped eyes of the dog kind of jammed inside that, inside the binding there, the door in the front. So there's a dog, a domed house, a palm tree, and a swimming pool. So the dog and the domed house, let's see if the next, nope, go back. So the binding itself becomes the domed house. And these are some of the edges of the panels inside holding the pages and revealed through a hole in a little roof piece that goes on top to define that shape. This is wire edge binding, the style that I invented some years ago, and that kind of golden color is the brass wire showing, and these sewing supports, tapes have thread crisscrossing back and forth over them, capturing that layer to hold the book together. I wanted flexibility. I was really going for flexibility here. And you can see that in the box, there is a large compartment. That's where the book lives. And then this closes down. It's just a narrow compartment. That's where the swimming pool and the palm tree are. So you can use the box together with the book to create a scene. And again, integration of box and book is important to me. Now, I'm going to go through these next. These are just models from different workshops that I do. Wire edge binding, showing the flexibility of the binding. This one we've got on the table over here, Urtext, published by Peter Koch. So you can come and take a look at that. Mars, another one of my projects, done in 15 copies, I believe. And that the accordion book that's lying there with the letters on it, that was where I started with this. It was just, you know, it was back in the 80s, late 80s, and Reaganomics was in full tilt, and there was a lot of money going into the arts, and I could just go into the studio and play, and then send books to the Bromers in Boston or Jim Cummins in New York, and they would sell them within a couple of weeks and send me money, and I could just play more. It was great fun. And then the first Persian Gulf War happened, and a lot of galleries closed, a lot of book dealers went out of business, and then I had to start doing more commissions. And my work really changed. But at this time, I was just playing. So that accordion book, if you open it up straight, it's just, you know, different letters, but then if you twist it in a certain way, it says God of War on one side and Aries and Mars on the other side. And I showed it to one of my clients, and I showed him the before I had the letters on it, and he said, well, it can't be a book unless it has words on it. So that's when I put the letters on it, and I showed it to him again. He said, well, I guess it's a book. And I don't know, it didn't make a lot of sense, but I enjoyed doing it. So I see if there's, nope, there's not another slide of that. And then down here, what I do in a lot of my work, and I think we had a conversation about this too, it doesn't show here, but in that box there's a compartment for the sculptural book, and then I put a narrative of the making of this project. And I can remember we talked about it and said, as someone who wants to show your work and really understand it and show it in a way that is significant, you need to know the story behind the work. So I started putting just a pamphlet with a narrative of my thoughts while I was making the book and kind of the story of the making of the book. And then also I put in the voice of Mars. And I tried to write the voice of Mars, and I'm not very martial, so I was having a hard time, and I was talking with Greta about it, and she said, well, let's call my first husband in, and he'll help us. So, and he's not that martial either, but maybe you know differently than I do. But he came down for a weekend, and three of us were working on the voice of Mars, and I was getting more and more agitated. I thought, this is too much, I'm talking to my father. And he said, Dan, would you like me to take what we've done? We pretty much finished. And he said, I'll just take it home and put the finishing touches on it and send it to you, which he did the next week. And I got it, and he had added a line at the end of the voice of Mars that said, I am your father. And every time I read that, right now I'm getting goosebumps just thinking about it. Yeah. I realized in a dream once that the only way that I could talk with my father is if I put him under my arm and flew into the sky. If I disconnected him from the ground, he would pay attention to me. So I used to have dreams of me flying around with Dad, you know, right? Hey, Dad, here's what I'm thinking. Yeah. But then those three little objects at the bottom, too, it's I call them the faces of Mars. This one over there is a canister ball from the Civil War battlefield, then a chrome steel ball bearing. Kind of Mars in his Sunday going to church outfit. And then the one at the irregular shape one is a iron nickel meteorite from a stream field in Namibia. So I'm doing 15 copies. I did 15 copies. I had to call up the meteorite company and say, I need 15 meteorites all about the same size. And explain to them why. So that's celestial Mars. And that has regmaglipped edges. It's pinched edges. So it means that meteorite fragmented in space, you know, in the atmosphere, and they said that they found tens of thousands of these little meteorites in that stream field in Namibia. So that'd be a fiery rain of Mars coming to Earth. So in a lot of the books, I will put the narrative, I'll put the voice of the character that I'm trying to portray or represent by the book, and then material stuff, physical stuff that people can pick up. This was a collaboration with Tim Ely. It's the only structure that I did, or the only book that I did that has no permanent hinging. And you can see there are square pages and triangular pages, and then that scroll, I think we've got a slide, yeah. So the scroll opens with pins, and there's a drawing that gives you a hint of how to put this together. There are lots of ways of putting it together. A lot of my books don't have words in them, and even this first one that I showed, normally it has something on these surfaces. I left them uncovered so that people could see the way that the paper gets cut to put it together. But I look at a lot of these devices as apparatus or a device for people to discover their own stories, because they'll pick these things up and start playing with it, and especially this one and some others that I've done, and they just start talking about associations that they've made with the movements that they're doing. Having movement, something that's non-traditional book movement, it brings up all sorts of ideas, and they just start telling stories, and I really love that. So this one, you can put it together this way, and then it pins together into a cube octahedron. Tim, do many of you know Tim's work? So, yeah, Tim's from another planet. When Greta and I had our nonprofit, and we had to list all the teachers that we invited and their country of origin, and that we looked at each other when we got to Tim and we said, alien. And I told Tim that, and he said, you know, that makes a lot of sense. He's got a cryptic language too, but he said, you know, I did the Google satellite view of my dad's hardware store, the only job other than making books that he's ever had, and it looks a lot like a spaceship, and you know, I don't know anything about my ancestors, so Tim's from another planet someplace. And I always looked at these collaborations with Tim as kind of globes from alien worlds, so it all makes sense. When I was in England, trip at least 20 years ago, I went to a bindery in I can't remember where the bindery was, in an abbey someplace in Devon, and they had just cut down a 1,000-year-old English yew tree in the cemetery. Of course, I've never talked with anybody there that the yew tree wasn't at least 1,000 years old. And they gave me a plank of the wood and said, here, would you like to take this? And I did, and they let me through customs with that plank of wood. It must have been about that long, and I'm just carrying it on my arm. And I was listening when I decided to make this book, which is called Religio Mathematica. I was listening to Bill Moyer's interviews with Joseph Campbell, and he's talking about the word religion having the same root as ligament. It links us to our past. And I thought, well, the wire edge binding structure is kind of that way. And I make really strong geometric forms, so I wanted to have that geometric form rising out of the live edge of that tree, that plank of wood. So it comes out of the box and it forms lots of different shapes. It's 12 four-sided volumes. They are tetrahedrons, but they're not regular tetrahedrons. But this is, it makes lots of shapes to the point where I would take it to a party and just let people play with it. And again, they would start telling stories and talking about associations. And this one got to be known as the lotus position. And when you close the lotus, when you take these three sides and bring it up and those three points touch, it's the inverted cube. It starts out with red on the outside. Well, in that form, it's red on the inside. And the opening and closing of the lotus can be, or is considered in some mythologies, the beginning and ending of a universe. So this book, without words on it, to me, represents a cosmogony. It's a beginning and ending of a universe. And again, it makes lots of shapes. And when people play with it, they start telling stories. And some of them are pretty interesting stories. Collaboration with Barbara Farner. She's a German artist. And because wire edge binding has wire in it, she said, well, let's do an alchemical book. This is called The Philosopher's Stone. It opens up to four compartments, one for each of the elements. And I said, well, I'll use wire in it. And she was so funny, talking about materials. And ideas about materials in different countries. Well, a lot of German bindings were the staple bindings around a tape support, and those staples were all not stainless steel, and they all rusted. And she said, in Germany, we don't like metal in our bindings, and it's because of that, the steel rusting in those, but I assured her that this one wasn't gonna rust, and if it did hit conditions that would make the metal corrode, the book was gone anyway. How are we doing for time?
We need about 15 minutes before 4.
Okay, so Neo Emblemata Nova. Well, Emblemata Nova. It was done by Michael Merritt, an emblem book from, the first edition was 1617, and the collection here has one of the I did two editions of this. The first edition done in 5 copies, and it's here in the collection. And do you know emblem books? What's your understanding of an emblem book from the 17th century? Anything? It's all images. And this one's also known, or Michael Mayer called it Atalanta Fugians, and he did a fugue for each of the 50 images in this book. But what I loved about it is it was a way for the alchemist to portray lots of knowledge in emblematic form. There was a unwritten rule that you didn't want to initiate people to this or tell them too much, because just like the Golden Book of Chemistry experiments, it was too potent, you know, and also they were protecting their information. So each one of these images represents an alchemical process. And one of them, I've actually, in the videos, I build alchemical furnaces and do transformation material. And one is cupellation, which is the purifying of impure precious metals. And it shows a fallen king in the foreground, which would be impure gold. And a gray wolf is devouring the king And then in the background, there's a fire, and the king is emerging rejuvenated from the fire. Well, that's the process of drawing all the impurities out of that impure metal. So it's all, this is all cryptic information. And so I wanted to pick a binding that would represent that cryptic information. So non-traditional binding, you know, unusual. It's a Mobius strip. Do you guys know Mobius strip? Mathematically, it's a one-sided object. So you can easily make a Mobius strip from a strip of paper, just put a half twist into it, tape the ends together, and you can put a pencil down anywhere and just pull the paper past the pencil, and you'll draw a line on a Mobius strip, returning to the beginning, having drawn on both sides of the paper. So you can hold this book and look at each of these images, and you'll eventually come back to your starting point having seen the images on both sides of the panels, but you never have to turn the book over. So I wanted to match the binding to the cryptic nature of the material that was shown. And so Mobius strips seem to do that. Now there are some problems with the Mobius strip, or you know, Mobius strip with a soft material like paper is easy to do. Here it's rigid panels, so you have to put a half twist in it, but you can't do a twist on a rigid panel, so these diagonal hinging panels come into play. Every time you close one of those, that's a quarter twist. So you need to, when you put it back into the box, you have to do two of those, but you have to leave two of them flat because there are four of them in here. So you really need a mentor to put this back in the box. And Ann Anninger, when she was the rare book librarian at the Houghton Library at Harvard, called me up one day. She bought one of these copies also and said, "Dan, we need a video. Our patrons are having a hard time putting it back in the box." In fact, the one of the last books I showed you, the one that had the lotus position, Religio Mathematica, I took that model and gave it to Richard Minsky for a show at Center for Book Arts in New York, and I got that one back in a garbage bag. Unclosed, just wide open. She couldn't figure out how to put it away. So in the new edition of this, I've included a little pamphlet, again, talking a little bit about the book so that there is a story, not just the artist book itself. And it tells you how to put it away by having a conversation with my collaborator. So you go back to the beginning. Oh yeah, one of my friends also said that this isn't a book because it doesn't make the sound of a big dictionary closing. This one he would call a clacker. So in putting this back together, you would go to the title page or to the frontish, which has a picture of Michael Mayer. Let's see, we'll get there eventually. I was trying to figure out how to rig this up with a mechanical device for a show at Smith College Library, or Art Museum, so that people could kind of turn the book from outside the case, but never got around to that. Well, here's the title page and Michael. So you have a conversation with Michael, and you fold the second one. See, I don't believe in cause and effect anymore. It's all an invitation. So if I can't do this, it's because I'm not living properly or something. Oh yeah, look at that. It went so easily a few minutes ago when we were looking at it, so let me try one more time. I have to pay homage to the gods here.
Don't worry, apparently there's a video about this, about how to do it.
Yeah, there is a video. So here we go. I think it's going to work this time. There we go. But I like books that have movement. You know, the movement is really important because it brings the body into play in the book. You know, I love the computer just for its the ease of finding information, but I like to pick up a book and hold it. And Tim Ely talks about proportioning his book so that it is proportioned to the body and forms that intimate relationship. You know, I used to make books that you could hold really easily, and lately I've been making these giant books which are no longer proportioned to the body.
But in my studio, I use English units, inches, feet, yards. I used it as a chemist. I always did metric. But I switched back to the English units because I like the relationship to the body. You know, the inch, a digit like that, the foot, the yard. So there seems to be an intimate relationship to the body that I just like to bring in because of the physicality of my work. Also, different materials. And on the table, you'll see some metals. Oops, this one's there. Oh, this one's been dropped. See what it dinged on that
corner. Never.
Maybe we can.
Never.
Never. Metal binding. You know, so when I did this book for Granary, it's Mesmer, my collaborator was Tony Dove, and she was an installation artist in New York and did a lot of projected imagery onto transparent materials. So she went to Canal Street and found perforated aluminum, some screening material, we got some plastic, and put it in front of me at our first meeting and said, can you make it into a book? Which is a question I often get. And metal, the only book that I had seen in metal at this point, this is quite, this has got to be 20 years ago, was the Museum of Modern Art catalog for the exhibition called The Machine. And it was a regular exhibition catalog that had metal wrapped around the spine with a piano hinge, and it was riveted through, which was good because that perfect, so-called perfect binding would never fall apart with those rivets going through it, but of course it didn't open very well. But I wanted a book that would open fully to the spine. So I always look around in nature for models, and the model that I found for this was insects and crustaceans. It's a, you know, hard material forming the exoskeleton for the book, and then soft material, ligaments or thread, holding the fleshy interior. So when you look at this binding, there are threads, pairs of threads in four places on the central wire. The outside two wires hold the covers, and the thread wrapped around the central wire are the ligaments that hold the fleshy interior to it. So, again, always looking around for existing models and reinterpreting those models for use in a modern structure. Let's see, what else? If you guys have questions, please feel free to ask as we go along. Now, this was
question. Dan, did you invent the Mobius book? I mean, the structure.
Well, I invented wire edge binding, and I did the engineering on that, so I guess you could say I invented that one. You could make Mobius strip books out of strips of paper, though, but this one required a lot of engineering. This one, do you guys know Too Much Bliss, Henrik Drescher's book? This one has a funny story to it. Steve Clay published this, and Steve and I went over to Hudson, New York to visit Henrik in his studio, and on his studio wall he had big sheets of natural rubber, and every once in a while in our conversation he would punctuate the conversation actually by kind of rolling around on the natural rubber, and he did it enough times I said, Henrik, would you like to use some of that material in your book? He said, yeah, can we? Well, natural rubber is not a very stable material. It's actually, this one's holding up quite nicely. And you know, I tell people that I usually like to use archival materials, and natural rubber certainly doesn't fit that, but it fit Henrik's aesthetic perfectly. So other copies of this book that I've seen, well, the rubber can either go gummy or it can go hard and brittle, and this one has stayed nice and flexible, so you have good conditions here in the store. But other places, the rubber has gone hard and brittle and kind of broken, but broken in interesting ways. So the engineering thing here was, how do you take a really flexible material like that and put it into a binding in a stable way? And so I was trying to figure out how to interface, and I ended up sewing it to a paper that wraps around the wire. But
I can't tell you how many times I ran into conservators after this came out, and they, Frank Mowry especially, and say, now about that rubber that you're using in that book, and said, it'll keep you in business, Frank, it'll give you something to do. And it's, you know, it's an aesthetic choice. Here, Henrik and Steve Plate, who has Granary Books, decided that we would choose the rubber for its aesthetic quality and how it matched Henrik's aesthetic, rather than worrying completely about the archival, non-archival quality of the material.
Hey, Daniel, we promised them 4 o'clock.
4 o'clock, okay.
So people who, because I know some people skip lunch, so they can come in at 3 for an hour. It's 4 o'clock, so if we have the 4 o'clock people who want to get up and go, this would be a good time.
Thank you. Thank you for skipping lunch.
And then we'll go back to Daniel's conversation.
Perhaps you got that sheet rubber from that rubber shop on Canal Street.
Yeah, it's a lot of stuff.
That stuff might be vulcanized.
Oh, it is vulcanized. Yeah, it's not raw rubber. It is vulcanized rubber, but still, that's not. It doesn't last forever. So there is always that concern. Please.
So you've mentioned one friend who says it's not a book that doesn't have words, and somebody else says it's
didn't have that sound. Right.
Do you have a definition in your mind?
Well, if we went strictly with the, look at the root of the word book, it's either Dutch or German Bach from, meaning beech tree, right? So none of these books up here have beechwood in them, so strictly speaking, I guess they're not books either. So it's a convention. You know, everything that we're doing is a construction. We construct a universe, so we decide to call something a book and something else not a book. My simple answer to people that would say it's not a book, I say, well, a book dealer sells it, so it must be. But that's a cop-out. You know, it's just, I love making the stuff. I'm really a sculptor, is what I am. And I love the sculpture quality of books, so I just decided to do that. How would you respond to someone that says it's not a book?
I'm not sure. When I look at some of these things, I think, what makes this a book instead of a sculpture?
Well,
and
I'm
trying to figure that out.
I mean, I've seen plenty of so-called books that are just like an open book that's made out of another material, but it's in a book form. And it doesn't move. You know, books to me move. You have to be able to pick them up. You have to have some sort of relationship to it, an intimate relationship. You know, books can sweep you away. The words can sweep you away, but I like to bring in the physicality of the book. The first one that I did that really showed this to me was a book called Love Album, and it was short stories by two people living in Newburyport, Massachusetts, Ruth Winfield Love, also known as Lady Love, and her husband, Joe Brown Love. And it was Texas Childhood. The subtitle was Texas Childhood, 1904 to 1914. And each one of them had 5 short stories in the book, and they brought me in. It was a little bitty format, and I said, now this is Texas, and their stories were big stories. I said, let's make a bigger book. So it was 22 inches wide and 15 inches tall, and it was an accordion that opened to, I think it was 60 feet. And the way that the Love showed that, and this was, they had a strong connection to Texas, so they finished I finished the first copy after 4 straight all-nighters. I was hallucinating by the time I finished the first copy and falling to the floor and waking up on the floor. But they took the first book to Texas, and they said that the way that they showed it was really pretty cool. 60 feet long, so they'd come into a room with carpeting on it, and I think they sold the first copies to SMU and to University of Texas. And they would open the book up zigzag fashion on the floor and ask people to crawl on the floor and read it, because it's kids' stories, right? And there were pop-ups and that sort of thing. And they said that after, you know, these people in suits, a lot of people in suits, they literally would get down and they turned into kids after, you know, crawling 10 feet on the floor. And I thought, yes, see, the physical nature of the book can be transformative as well as the text and imagery of the book. So that's when I really fell in love with making books that moved in unusual ways. Well, to go back to your question about, you know, what makes them books, I think that they need to have movement. You know, they open and close, so that you can literally open and close the book somehow. And all of these, you know, including this, you know, opens and closes. You don't see all the surfaces at one time. I think one of the big differences between books and art, like paintings, are that, you know, painting, even though you may not understand the whole set of imagery, you see the whole surface at one time. But with a book, you don't. And I do books that have multiple pathways. I mean, you can have a singular pathway through a book, or you can have multiple pathways. You can enter at different places and go differently. And if the book has some sort of complex movement associated with it, then the multiple pathways becomes very significant. So you can't see the whole thing in one glance. It has movement, it has page surface. Let's see. I don't have one here. I do some that are rotating rings. I guess they were, officially it would be called a hexaflexahedron. Back in the 60s they were called the cosmic donut. And it's six tetrahedron linked in a circular form, and it rotates through the center.
Hexaflexa,
it'd be a hedron. It's not a flat one. The flat ones are guns, but the ones with volume are hexaflexahedrons.
The ones with volume. Martin Gardner made them popular.
Yeah, but that it shouldn't be a gun. You know, it should be a hedron because it has permanent volume to it. And I ran into someone, a mathematician in England, who is part of a worldwide group exploring different structures like this. So he's been able to give me some other structures to turn into books. But, you know, the non-traditional forms, even though it might not be recognizable as a book, you know, the way that we think of books, codex books now, they're really just complex accordion structures. You know, so if you have six tetrahedrons linked to each other, and the ones that I make, you can pull pins out and it goes flat, and you see the neck, basically it's a tube that it turns into. But it's just an accordion, but with hinging off of all edges rather than off of just two edges on each page. And if you accept an accordion as a book, then these complex accordions would also be books. But I like them just because they evoke different feelings and ideas. There's a piece pagoda near where my studio is, and Katashon, the monk at the pagoda, came into the studio one day and he picked up this rotating ring and he started playing with it and he said, perfect structure to hold my mantra. You know, it doesn't have a beginning and an end, it's a circular movement, and so it's meditative in a way that a traditional codex book might not be. So it can help tell the story. We have a question in the audience.
I have a suggestion. And with what you're saying, how about showing them skipping ahead to the Taube Auerbach one based on Pascal's triangle?
Okay, let me see if I can escape this.
And then maybe you could switch to these, since all these great books are out here.
Oh yeah, we want to look at these. Let me. I'm not the computer person in our family. Yes. Oh, that one. So not one of the videos. Okay. Yeah.
The fractal book.
This modern technology is just way beyond me. I just okay, yeah. So just skipping down. Okay, yeah.
Well, you also want to show the album, the post-bound binding.
Should I show that one too?
Well, after you do this, you can go back to it. They need to see the post-bound.
Okay, let's see. So, yeah, I mean, so is it a book? I mean, it's a book sculpture, and this one could open and close, but frankly, you wouldn't want to. Taube Auerbach, who's an artist in New York City, commissioned me to do this. We've done a number of collaborations. She wanted to explore fractal branching.
So here's a book that's, this is 4 inches, and then there's another four, so 16 inches from spine to foredge. And every 4 inches, the pages split, branch into 11 additional pages. So you have a single leaf coming out from the spine, then 11 leaves, and then in 4 inches, each of those branches into 11 leaves, and then you get 11 more out of that. So you go from 1 to 11 to 121 to 1,331 leaves in the, for the spine and the foredge. And let's see, I have a close-up of, yeah, so there's a close-up of the branching. So it doesn't, it's not really meant to open and close, but it is made out of book materials. Now, I don't know, this one might be, I would call this one probably more of a sculpture than a book because I can't really operate it. And in fact, it was supposed to be, these ribbons on either side were meant to close the book and keep it in that, in the closed form, but I made it, and it took 300 hours to make this thing. I think my assistant did 100 hours, and I did 200 hours in putting it together, and we decided that it was going to be a one-of-a-kind an addition. But it wouldn't hold together. I couldn't close it and keep it in that form. This is Mohawk Superfine, and I think that 4-inch foredge, so when the book is closed, it's 16 inches tall, and 16 inches thick, and that foredge of 1,331 leaves of Mohawk Superfine weighs 30 pounds. So, you know, a single leaf coming out of the spine wasn't going to hold that 30 pounds of paper at the foredge. I think it's a beautiful sculpture, but yeah, this one would be less book to me and more sculpture. Is that the direction that you were thinking of with that? And then
it illustrates a mathematical reality.
Oh, yeah. The phrase that came up at least back when we were still arguing about what defines a book, I don't know if we do that so much anymore,
yeah,
is bookwork.
Bookwork.
Which kind of eliminates the need for it to be a functioning book, but it's a book-like object,
yeah.
So it's a bookwork,
yeah.
Which this would certainly be.
Mm-hmm. Well, and this one, yeah. I mean, it was a great, it was a fun project. I had a full head of hair when I started that project. But then, Sasha, I'll go back, let's see if I can escape here, and I'll see. So we'll go up and look at the, well, here's, okay, so this would also, this one functions, these function more as books, though. So the one on the left we call marble, the one on the right is wood, and what Talbot did with these is to take a block of marble and to scan all surfaces and then grind off the thickness of the page and scan it again and do that 40 times through the block of marble. And then we printed each of the pages and I bound it as a board book. So it's a...
Wow.
So there are folds here. You'd open it, there'd be another fold, and they're glued together. So you can take a meander through a block of marble or through a block of wood. Again, no words, but in book form. So would that be a book work thing? Or it is more of a structural, functional book?
I don't know. I mean, it's an interesting question in some ways, and isn't it all interesting in other ways? I mean, you know, the string book. Is a book, as far as I'm concerned. It has a narrative, it has a read to it, as does this.
But that one, yeah, I like the movement and the sound when you open the pages. It's Keith Smith.
Yes.
Yes, as you open the pages, the string drags through and shows connection. I like how that shows connection. There is connection here. I mean, Talbot's a conceptual artist, right? She's, most of her work is strongly conceptual, and I mean, I think we did a good job in making it look like marble and wood. She said at the opening for the show that these were first in. She had to tell people a remarkable number of times that no, it wasn't actually a block of marble and a block of wood, but it's conceptual. Let's see. Well, actually, one of the others of Tava's is this one.
And this gives me an opportunity to say that
there are opportunities for donations to the Library of Congress. We do accept both checks and cash. This is a book that's on our desiderata list.
Yeah.
Unfortunately.
Yeah. It's sold by Paula Cooper Gallery.
It's a very expensive book, but look at this magnificent book.
Well, I ran into someone recently who worked at Christie's, and he said he wanted to buy some of Talbot's paintings. I mean, she's young, but she's really doing a fantastic job for herself. She's so connected. He bought some of the books instead because they were affordable. You know? I think her paintings are $800,000 a hit.
How much?
$800,000. Yeah, this is all paper. This is, it's called RGB Color Volume Atlas. Color Atlas, and it's how many pages? Was this 1,200 pages? I can't remember. It's a lot of pages, and what she did was she developed a program for taking the RGB space and transitioning through the whole volume, but doing it from each of the three major axes.
It was an animation originally.
Yeah, there is. Okay, so there are three volumes to this book. So you do get three volumes. So notice it's the same volume. Here's color volume. There's yellow, 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 red, 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 all in the same place. But here's the spine on this one. Here's the spine on this one. And the spine on this one is probably on the top. Yeah, so it opens through that color volume from the three major axes. So you can look at the transition all the way through. And actually, an artist called me and said, is this available in, you know, a less expensive commercial form, because he'd like to actually use it in his work, just to see color transition. So it could be a tool. But this one, I said, well, there are only four copies available. They exhibit nicely. That was a show at the Kunsthalle in Bergen, Norway. Yeah, that's a pitch. Yeah, they exhibit nicely. Yeah.
You can start a fund, people can just pay for the
But let's go, I'll show you, let's see, yeah, this one. So I'll go up to, yeah, you can see the, if I do it quickly, it's like a video going through. The trouble with bindings like this, where there's the Chicago Post going through, is that in order for this structure to function, usually you open with the spine to the left, you go halfway through, the spine goes vertical, and then when you get to the second half of the book, the spine rotates to the right. Well, this is probably 2 feet by 3 feet, so it's a big heavy book. So rather than, and the spine would be trapped under the cover as you open the book, so rather than having the spine move, I developed this progressive hinging. So it progressively gets longer between the pair of hinges, so as the book opens, the spine can stay in place. And each page just climbs up over the previous pages. So that took a bunch of prototyping to get there. But it actually works.
So we have a natural break because webcast is going to shut down.
Okay.
Because they have to. And that means,
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.